Go.
Father, we're grateful for this time to gather. Thank you for Pastor Andy leading us. We do pray this chapter help us grow in understanding the victory that you have secured for us, and be aware of the enemies that face us, and help us to apply the things that you want us to see today. And we do pray for Lucas, that you be with them, bring healing in his life from cancer, and certainly Gina's mom as well, and comfort Gina and family, and think of Lucas's family too. And for John and his daughter, Jerusha, that surgery would go well, she would recover well, and that she could perhaps even be getting around within the week. And so we pray that the mom would be a comfort as well as your spirit in her life this week. So give us teachable hearts now in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Bob. Okay, so everybody, this is the Clay Karras Bible Study. Every Friday, 8 a.m., you can Zoom in from wherever. Zoom into our Clay Karras neighborhood of Carmel, Indiana. Details of how to do that are at clayterrace.org. That's clayterrace.org. And we're in Revelation, chapter 13 this morning. And let's just start off reading a couple or three verses, whatever fits. Tyrone, you ready to lead us off?
Yes, I am.
Already, great. And then Pastor Hunt will end up wrapping up and take it from there. And certainly we appreciate him and leading us in our study each week. So, yeah, thank you, Tyrone.
Okay. Revelation 13, the first beast. This is the ESV version. First three chapters, first three verses. And I saw a beast rising out of the sea with 10 horns and 7 heads with 10 diadems on its horns and blasphemous names on its heads. And the beast that I saw was like a leopard. Its feet were like a bear's and its mouth were like a lion's mouth. And to it the dragon gave his power and his throne and great authority. One of its heads seemed to have a mortal wound, but its mortal wound was healed. And the whole earth marveled as they followed the beast.
And they worshiped the dragon, for he had given his authority to the beast. And they worshiped the beast, saying, "Who is like the beast, and who can fight against it?" And the beast was given a mouth uttering haughty and blasphemous words, and it was allowed to exercise authority for 42 months. It opened its mouth to utter blasphemies against God, blaspheming his name and his dwelling, that is, those who dwell in heaven.
And the beast was allowed to wage war against God's holy people and conquer them. And he was given authority to rule over every tribe and people and language and nation. And all the people who worship the beast, they are the ones whose names were not written in the book of life that belongs to the Lamb, who was slaughtered before the world was made.
If anyone has an ear, he should listen. If anyone is destined for captivity, into captivity he goes. If anyone is to be killed with a sword he will be killed. Here is the endurance and the faith of the saints.
Then I saw a second beast coming out of the earth. It had two horns like a lamb, but it spoke like a dragon. It exercised all the authority of the first beast on its behalf and made the earth and its inhabitants worship the first beast, whose fatal wound had been healed. And it performed great signs, even causing fire to come down from heaven to the earth in full view of the people.
Bob, verse 14. Let me read it. And then you read after me, Bob, if you're there. Because of the signs it was given power to perform on behalf of the first beast, it deceived the inhabitants of the earth. It ordered them to set up an image in honor of the beast who was wounded by the sword and yet lived. The second beast was given power to give breath to the image of the first beast so that the image could speak and cause all who refused to worship the image to be killed. Bob, you want to do 16? Otherwise, Andy.
Also, it causes all, both small and great, both rich and small, both free and slave, to be marked on the right hand or the forehead, so that no one can buy or sell unless he has a mark, that is, the name of the beast or the number of its name.
Praise God, praise God. Let's start this morning in verse 3. And look, as John tells us, one of his heads seemed to have a mortal wound, but the mortal wound was healed, and the whole earth marveled as they followed the beast. Here we see the resurrection of the beast against this background of John's understanding. And, you know, at this time, we have to enter into another character, Nero, the emperor of Rome, one of the most notorious figures in history. And he was a vain man. He was completely preoccupied with personal luxury. He bankrupted Rome, the imperial treasury, and then he confiscated all the property of the nobles to continue his spending. He was a violent man. And if you remember, he was falsely suspected of starting a horrible fire, which in 6 days burned most of the city of Rome. And this is AD 64. But he wanted to defect or that criticism against himself. So he blamed Christians. And then this started an incredible internal war against Christians to the point where Christians were tortured. And on the entryway into Rome, they were hung on poles and they were lit ablaze and they were used as street lights for people who were entering the city. So after this, rumor spread that he was going, you know, he committed suicide around AD 68. And rumor spread that he was going to come back from the dead. Now, what I'm trying to get at here is that Satan sets up this counterfeit resurrection, which has to deal with Nero. And there had been many rumors about the fact that he was not dead, that he was going to come back, and that he was going to take authority with those who had said many things about him and cast aspersions against him during the time of his death. And we see here that everything is built on this understanding that this is the one who received the mortal wound, but yet he came back. And we recognize here that when John is talking about this, he's talking about a beast who seemingly had a mortal wound. He comes back to life. And then you look at this in the light of all of the other emperors that followed Nero, whether it's Titus or Domitian or Vespasian, that came after him and had a similar effect on Rome's population, as well as the Christians in those areas. So we see that this symbolism here is just talking about the revival of these powerful men who were against, again, Christianity. This is that counterfeit resurrection that gives all the telltale signs of Satan being at work. Look at verse 4 here. And they worshiped the dragon, for he had been given authority to the beast, and the beast is the state. And they worshiped the beast, saying, who is like the beast, and who can fight against us? Here again, Rome, on the brink of collapse, and you start to see some of his great powers being restored. And when it says they looked upon the beast and said, who is like this beast and who can fight against him? You recognize that this is symbolism, because no one can look upon the hideousness of Satan. But okay, what does the devil always do? He dresses his representative up like an angel of light. And we see here that they are under this delusion. They are willing, humanity gladly worships the dragon that is disguised as the beast. And they all start to worship and to give authority to him. Now, it also tells us that those whose names were never written in the book of life are at the very mercy of the dragon and of the state as well. Look at verse 7. Also, it was allowed to make war on the saints and to conquer them, and authority was given over to them over every tribe and people and language and nation. We see here that we had several problems like this in Smyrna and Pergamon, where Christians have been prevented from buying or selling, and they've had their lives taken away from them because they refused to worship the beast. And this was something that Christians at that time were dealing with in John's day, and they recognized there was going to be a great penalty for refusing to renounce their faith in Jesus Christ and not acknowledging or agreeing to that they have faith in Caesar. Look at the Revelation 13, 8 through 10. And all who dwell on earth will worship it. Everyone whose name has not been written, before the foundation of the world in the book of life of the Lamb who was slain. If anyone has ear, let it hear. If anyone is to be taken captive, to captivity he goes. If anyone is to be slain with the sword he must be slain. Here is a call for the endurance and the faith of the saints. So we see here John, he can say without despair because he knows how the story ends. And really, we can always have great confidence because we know how the story ends. We win. John tells them that when the beast takes life of one of the saints, that saint will come to life and will reign with Christ Jesus for 1,000 years, taking their place with the church triumphant in heaven, that the multitude is so vast it cannot be counted, and there they will await for the resurrection of their very bodies. This leads us to understand that there is great certainty in what Christ Jesus is going to do for us. Look, go backwards for a minute. Look at Revelation 5, 12 through 13 for just a moment. Revelation 5, 12 through 13. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and praise. To him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be praise and honor and glory and power forever and ever. Now, we've taken a quick review of last week and now trying to go into the last verses in this particular chapter. There's no subject, I don't think, with the possibility of maybe in the New Testament a complete understanding of the unpardonable sin that brings much consternation as this understanding of the mark of the beast. Christians have a healthy suspicion of government, which pursues the church, any government that pursues the church and persecutes the church and hinders the preaching of the gospel. And this has led to a lot of questions in our day about how this mark of the beast is going to reveal itself. I sincerely doubt that it's going to be a technological invention or something that is a chip placed in us, but I think what John is talking about here, he's dealing with the fact that he wants to show us the complete understanding of the counterfeit trinity. It's a counterfeit trinity that comes into play here when he brings in this fourth character, which is a so-called false prophet. And I think we see here that John is talking about from verses 11 to 18, that the first beast which rises out of the sea, and now he says he sees a second beast. Look what he says here in 11. Then I saw another beast rising out of the earth. It had two horns like a lamb, and it spoke like a dragon. Now, I think there's some important things here. First, he says that this particular beast is called a false prophet. We see that later on in Revelation 16 and 13. Here, this same beast is depicted as this messianic pretender that comes out of the earth. Second, remember the first beast back in the beginning of this chapter, that beast came out of the sea. Now this beast comes out of the earth. And I think what John wants to show us is that the beast has influence over land and sea. And this beast is going to mimic the very kingdom of God and attract worship for himself. Now he tells us something else here. John says this beast has two horns like a lamb, but speaks like a dragon. This whole idea of the two-horned lamb is clearly someone who is imitating the seven-horned lamb who was slain back in Revelation 5 and 6. Therefore, this false Messiah is closely aligned with the first beast. His two horns are trying to mimic something. What is it trying to mimic? The two witnesses, the two lampstands, the two olive trees that we saw back in Revelation 11 and 2. So this false Messiah disseminates false worship and is directing people to something other than God. And we see here, together with the dragon, the beast, and the false prophet, they create this false trinity, and they place themselves in positions of power and authority with the goal to deceive the world and to receive the worship of all the people, every tongue, every language. You know, this should remind us of how incredibly important our singular worship to God is, that this is something that Satan always desires. I mean, even if we look back in Matthew at the baptism of Jesus, and you see that Jesus is led by the Spirit into the wilderness, what is Satan trying to do? He's saying, I'll give you everything if you just bow down and worship me. So there's a premium on our worship of God, and everything in this secular world is trying to tap into that. Not only is this a false Messiah that we see here, but he's like the master of religious deception. Look at Daniel chapter 8, verse 25. Daniel chapter 8, verse 25. By his cunning, he shall make deceit prosper under his hand, and in his own mind, he shall become great. Without warning, he shall destroy many, and he shall rise up against the prince of princes, and he shall be broken, but by no human hand. So we see Daniel is saying that this satanic force is exercising its power during this great upheaval. And then he goes a little bit further. If you look down in Daniel 8, 23 to 24, look backwards, 23 to 24. In the latter part of their reign, when rebels have become completely wicked, a stern-faced king, a master of intrigue, will arise. He will become very strong, but not by his own power. He will cause astounding devastation and will succeed in whatever he does. He will destroy the mighty man and the holy people. Daniel here is speaking of something that's coming to pass in the distant future. And then when we see ourselves here in Revelation, we see that John is speaking of a present reality that he's dealing with these Christians in the first century. The second beast has become continually associated with Christians by their understanding of the Roman emperor cult, which from my perspective, we see it's a Roman Catholic Church. There's a measure of truth in this assertion because we see that the New Testament warns us of false teachers will come and try to lead saints away from their Savior. We can look back at Matthew 24 and 5. Jesus warns us of false messiahs who will arise within the church. John, in his first epistle, warns us, dear children, this is the last hour. And as you have heard that the Antichrist is coming, even now, many Antichrists have come. This is how we know it is the last hour. They went out from us, but they did not really belong to us. For if they had belonged to us, they would have remained with us. But their going out showed that none of them belonged to us. That's 1 John 2:18-19. When we look at verse 7 here, we see here, John, it says, many deceivers who did not acknowledge Jesus Christ as coming in the flesh have gone out into the world. Any such person is the deceiver and the Antichrist. But here, Revelation 13, we see this second beast is not just a false messiah. This second beast has a specific purpose. Its purpose is to deceive people into worshiping the state. He's going to use every measure that he can, and he will be of great detriment to the faith for the time that he's allowed to reign. Verse 12 tells us that he exercises all authority over the first beast on his behalf and made the earth and its inhabitants worship the first beast whose fatal wound had been healed. So there's a connection here again to the false prophet, to the Roman Empire, to this cult worship, to the priests who devoted themselves to the emperor, to an extended number of pagan cults that regarded themselves as deity. You know, there were a lot of groups, especially in Asia Minor, that would bring a delegation to Rome. And they would come to Rome and tell the emperor that they were building a temple in their city so that they might properly worship them. And then their hope was to receive money to go back to help in the building of that temple, a new road or a new aqueduct. And it's amazing that this political quid pro quo is the same as it happens sometimes in our lives, that it hadn't really changed. That it's always something tit for tat, you know? But they were then allowed to go back and build their temples and their shrines and to practice whatever pagan worship they had promised to the emperors. So when we see this, we go back and we look that John is trying to tell us that Christians could not serve two masters simultaneously, even though the government says that you could serve Caesar and Jesus. So these false prophets were trying again, just like they did back in Revelation 11 with these two witnesses that were slain by the beast when the church was given power to bring destructive plagues upon the earth like Moses. Now it says that this beast is given the power to even bring down fire and to do miraculous miracles. Look at 13. And the false prophets performed great and miraculous signs, even causing fire to come down from heaven to the earth in full view of man. This should be no surprise to us. We saw this back in Genesis. Did not Pharaoh's magicians, weren't they able to perform some of the same signs that Moses did? You know, when Moses threw his staff on the ground and it turned into, well, they threw their staffs on the ground and turned into snakes. he threw his staff on the ground and turned to a larger snake and consumed them. So they're able to mimic some of the things of the Lord. But again, those things were only to deceive. And then, you know, it tells us in the New Testament, for false Christs and false prophets may appear and perform great signs and miracles to deceive. And I like this phrase, and many people misunderstand it, even the elect, if it were possible. Basically saying, okay, it's gonna be incredibly overwhelming, incredibly insightful, but it can't, it's like hyperbole here, that it's gonna be so good, it should be able to deceive the elect, but it really can't, because the elect know the truth. But it's gonna be that forceful and that attractive that there are gonna be, you know, some that are not elect that will fall for it.
Look so at verse. Andy, in context, so in historical context, I wanna make sure I understand what you're saying here. And of course, I think I remember you saying that you believe John wrote this after AD 70, am I right? So was already aware that Jerusalem had been ransacked and so forth, and that now we're up to potentially AD 94, 95. And if I, by the way, I wanna cover a question that was in the chat window, said, is John validating the Roman idea that Nero would be resurrected? So that kind of plays in. And if I heard you correctly, you're saying this first beast is the state. And again, we're talking all current things in John's time in approximately AD 95, because he was a very old man, right? He was a young disciple with Jesus. He's now a very old man. And then the second beast comes after that first one. At what point will we enter into anything in this chapter anyway that pertains to future, yet not even just our time, but beyond that? Clarify that, clarify any of that. Did I get any of that right?
Well, no, you're right on. Whether I understand the last part of the question is that I think when John is speaking of it, he's not validating the resurrection. I don't see where he's validating the resurrection of Nero, but he's saying that the resurrection of Nero is seen whenever these evil pretenders come into power and they carry on the desires and the program, the satanic program of Nero. You know, I'm gonna go out on a limb here, but I think I'm fine. I think you can earnestly and honestly see that in Hitler. I mean, I don't think people recognize how much the beginning of that was tied into Christianity. I mean, even today, what is it called? The German Christian Democratic Party. I mean, I'm not saying anything about Merkel or anything like that, but I'm just saying from a historic perspective, people don't understand that even the swastika was just a reconfiguration of the cross. I mean, there's a lot in there to understand that, okay, that here's another person that comes to power and does the same thing. You can see it in Stalin. I think we're gonna see it in our time when the state completely dominates and tries to change Christianity into their understanding of what Christianity should be. And anyone who doesn't agree with their understanding will be the church that will be persecuted. I think we see that clearly coming to fruition, even in China. You know, China was, because of their persecution of the church flourished and grew underground. So what did the communist government decide to do? They're gonna create their own type of Christianity because they're overwhelmed that, hey, this Christianity can really get subjects to operate in a way that will be palatable for us as long as we change what Christianity means. So they're trying to somehow come up with this different Christianity that they will allow to happen And, you know, I think the same thing is going to happen to us in this country. They're going to water it down to where it will really, from a biblical standpoint, lack any meaning that the scripture would provide for Christianity, but allow it to be tolerable, that the state will allow it to still function in this pseudo Christian era. And then we fall back into the same thing.
Okay, so with respect to the last part of what I'd said of anything that's futuristic, you're saying these are resurrected ideas of the first beast that are seen all the way from John's time to ours and into our future even.
It never stops. Satan is like a great pitcher who has fastball, off-speed pitch, maybe a knuckler and one other, and he just continues in the rotation. Never changes anything. Okay. He just finds out what your weakness is as a batter, and then he feeds you more of that.
Okay.
But, you know, things have not changed. He still has, even though he recognizes he's going to lose in the end, he still continues to present the proposition over and over and over again.
And of course, it kind of raises the question among folks that take it really literally. Well, I don't even know if that's the right term, but literally slash, hey, these things will happen in the future in some substantial way. Example, that second beast resurrecting an image to be worshipped. And I'm pretty sure that there are folks, maybe even in the room, that would believe this is a fulfillment of Daniel's abomination. That, yeah, say it again.
That's later. I think it first pictures Daniel 3 and Nebuchadnezzar ordering everyone, you know, to bow down and to worship that statue or that image. You know, even to the point that he took the three Hebrew boys and put them into the furnace for refusing to worship a golden image. I think it's probably later in 9 or 10 where you would get the abomination piece that you were talking about or referring to.
Yeah. Jim Wright, I don't know if you're tuned in right this minute, but if there's anything you want to pop in there. But yeah, I've been looking at that abomination that causes desolation that Jesus validates in his time, attributing it to the prophet Daniel. and I think that being the cause of, hey, if you're going to set up an idol to be worshipped, then of course there has to be a temple in which to place that worshipful idol or something. Jim, you off mute?
Yeah, I'm off mute.
What do you think? Did we get that? And again, this being the historic pre-mill point of view.
Right.
Any of that right? Well, from your perspective?
Yeah, from my perspective, chapter 12, Satan is thrown to the earth. And at that, we are now entering, we are at the Great Tribulation midpoint. Started midpoint of the tribulation, which is now the Great Tribulation. Satan is definitely furious. He's coming after Israel. He's also coming after the saints. So we see that in chapter 12. So, you know, literally all hell is breaking loose. And you've got, again, the rise of the world government and the Antichrist here, and the Antichrist setting up there in the Holy of Holies, his image. And so that's what you've got going on here. And then, of course, the lamb, the other beast that has two horns like a lamb, is the false prophet who will work alongside the Antichrist. And I'm with Greg. I tend to believe that's probably going to be the leader of the Roman Catholic Church. And so now you've got really the unholy trinity at work here. And so that's what's going on from a more literal perspective. Mm-hmm.
Well, I thought that'd be good context before we hit that verse 18, the number is going to be what? 666. Ready, go, Andy. What do we need to know?
I'm just cheering Jim because I thought I was going to get some major feedback attacking Rome, but I think it's just clear that the problem is Rome. You cannot have anyone that says that they're the vicar of Christ. I mean, that flies in the face of what the Bible teaches. And to take that kind of authority, and then when we just look at the way that whole piece has been built, that you know, the word Catholic means what?
Universal.
Okay, so the thing that pollutes and perverts the word is the word Roman, that turns it into something that it was never supposed to be. So
I think we're seeing this again. I feel like we're fairly close to all this. We're seeing this because Rome is cuddling up to the Islamic world very much. Pope Francis is now basically calling for civil unions as far as homosexuality. Seeing that. So I think you're seeing the Roman Catholic Church is really getting positioned to be a part of that. I don't know if Pope Francis is the who knows, but we're certainly seeing the trend.
Christ, but he's definitely working for him.
He will be the false, whoever it is will be the false prophet, not the Antichrist. The Antichrist will be the political leader, or the most powerful political leader, and he won't be the only king. There'll be, as I believe, 10 kings. The earth will be into 10 sections. Of course, we've already seen the UN has done that, divided the earth into 10 sections for their 2015, I believe, plan, 2030 thing. But you'll have the Antichrist and the false prophet. They will be working alongside each other. So you'll have the religious leader and the political leader who will be working. But I think we see signs of that coming.
And of course, Jesus had said, hey, there's going to be many false prophets.
Sure.
And don't ask me which one of the apostles then said, we've already seen some of those false prophets.
Sure.
And many antichrists, John says, many antichrists, but not the
right.
Antichrist. The and by the way, Garrett, the two of you, each of you answered. So in Thessalonians, where it talks about the man of lawlessness, should we definitely equate that with antichrist, the antichrist? Yes or no?
I always have.
What do you think, Andy?
Yes.
Okay. All right. Okay. Sorry for me interrupting, but that helped me understand what you were saying.
Being restrained, yes.
All right. 666. What are we going to do with it?
Okay. This is a take the mark. They are being forced to take the mark to worship the beast and the dragon. And now I think this is what's happening here, that the mark of the beast is like a first century phenomenon, as well as something that's going to happen in the future, whether it would be as literal in the future. You know, back, I think John is dealing with an allusion to the fact that in the days of they tattooed slaves and they had different various religious rites that indicated that a person was given a mark that showed who owned them or who they were devoted to. I don't know if we recognize, I always try to tell men who wear earrings that when you wear earrings, that it was a sign in Egypt that you were a slave and you belonged to someone. When I see this, I think the mark of the beast is just the stamp of the state's approval upon you, and that you will willingly go along with their religious demands from the government that have been made by the state. I think it literally will not allow you to buy or sell. And just as it happened in Rome, there was either Caesar Curios, Caesar's Lord, or Jesus Kyrios, Christ is Lord. So, you know, you remember even they were calling Christians atheists because they wouldn't say that Caesar was Lord. So now when we see this, if you go back and you look at 666, it's a gematria, which is you take, especially in ancient, you can do it in Hebrew and you can do it in Greek. You take the word dragon and you take the word beast, and then they have a numeric value. And you add up the total of those two words and they come out to 666, which is the image of man or the total of man. And we recognize that that fits in with 777, the perfect number for Christ. So it just shows again the counterfeit nature of what this Antichrist is bringing. That number never is a symbol for all those rulers and false teachers, and shows their synthetic nature against the people of God. And again, I think if you go back and you can see newsreels, go to the library, you can see newsreels with German children singing, Hitler is our savior, Hitler is our Lord. So it's just gonna be another reincarnation of that person from the political realm that comes to bring great havoc upon the earth. But we, as Christians, I believe totally, and the Bible teaches that we're sealed with the name of God in Christ in our baptism. Our hope is not to escape our enemies through some rapture, but to be able to fight and to overcome sin. And even if we're slain, you know, if we're slain today, we rise up the next day because we have eternal life. And we see where those back in the earlier part of Revelations, when they're under, I think it's in 6, when they're under the altar and they're asking, Lord, how long before our blood is vindicated? And he says, just wait a little while longer. So we have the surety that the Lord, if this world kills us, he brings us back to life. And if we continue to preach the gospel, even in times of great persecution, that we will hear those words from him, well done, my good and faithful servant. Since we understand, as John understood, that we win, then I think that is what we have to keep first and foremost in our mind. We have to be like Christ, which is said in the days leading up to the crucifixion, that he focused upon the cross like a flint. He's looking past, you know, what's going to happen. And you see the way he reacts to the situation in the Garden of Gethsemane. I mean, we see Christ really go through the crucifixion in the Garden of Gethsemane as he prays 3 times, if this cup can pass, that's his human nature, but then his divinity takes over and says, no, not my will, but yours be done, because he recognizes the great prophet. And when I said prophet, I'm talking about the great wealth prophet to us that comes out of his once for all sacrifice of dying on the cross, death, burial, and resurrection, that brings redemption to us and life eternal. So he looked past the pain and looked toward the promise. And I think that we're called to look past the pain and look past the persecution, but look forward to the promise, because our Lord is faithful. And that everything that's in here is going to come to pass in some way, and we'll be challenged by that. But again, if we're focused on the end game, you know, I'm not a fan of McConnell, but I love the fact that Mitch McConnell is always playing the long game. He's always playing the long game, regardless of what happens. He's playing, he is 10 steps in front of me. He's willing to suffer a loss here because he sees a greater victory there. And I think we have to get in that mindset. We have to toughen up and say, okay, This is they have not just opened Pandora's box, they have dumped it out and wiped it. But that's okay, because it only verifies that this book is true.
Okay, so before we ask our Clay Terrace question, Jim, you want to throw in 2 cents about it? You want to throw in 666 cents about the 666? You're on mute, though.
Sorry there. I obviously humanity is going to take some sort of mark to be able to buy and sell. I don't know when this is all going to happen, but certainly I see precursors of it right now. Greg was talking about tattoos. If you notice how many people are now tattooed all over themselves, people in our culture today don't really think twice about getting tattooed anymore. Again, the coronavirus is not the mark of the beast or the vaccine or anything like that. But it's very interesting that I was reading a paper from MIT where they've actually developed a way of delivering a vaccine where they can put an infrared, it's an enzyme that glows when you wave a specially equipped smartphone over to show that you've actually been vaccinated. And this was from MIT. This wasn't from a conspiracy website, by the way. It was a paper from MIT that they've developed. And, you know, of course, they haven't used anything like this. It's a micro needle type patch thing that they've developed. And they said it would last for up to 5 years, that a person would be able to be identified up to 5 years. Now, I don't think that's in production or anything, but my point is that technology is there. And what the virus has shown me is that people will submit to that if they're afraid enough. And just see what we've happened worldwide. So I think, you know, I believe this stuff's literally going to happen, and you're going to see a world in such turmoil. And you get a leader on stage that says, look, you know, we've got rampant crime, we've got all this stuff happening, and we need to be able to make sure that, you know, people, we can't have all the people stealing, we've got to have control. So we need to have this, whatever it's going to be, that you're going to have this identification you're going to have on you so you can buy and sell. And again, we've already seen too in the coronavirus how not only just the governments will talk about the vaccination cards and all this, but we've also seen private businesses, airlines are saying, well, you can't fly if you don't prove blah, 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 you don't have the vaccination. We've already seen. So I you know, to me, yeah, I don't know what that mark is. I don't know exactly how it'll be delivered. All I'm saying is there are technologies in place to make it done, have it done today. Okay. And so, we have the ability to track people.
Yeah. Well, and you know, as we ask our Clay Terrace question, hey, it's Friday at Clay Terrace, what do we do with this? You know, as you guys have talked about the mark and you can't buy or sell. Of course, in John's time, as he's writing to these seven churches, I'm thinking they're like, hey, we already know about not being able to buy or sell if we get thrown out of the temple, you know, being Jewish folks, and we've been excommunicated from Judaism. We can't buy or sell, you know, and it really even becomes life, real tangible life issues. So I dare say that's kind of always been the case. Whenever there was some mimicking religion of which true Israel, true Christ followers, if we're faithful to follow him, we're going to find ourselves on the outside of that system, maybe. Hey, anybody else want to chime in? What are you going to do with this today? It's Friday at Clay Terrace.
Run and hide.
Yeah, anybody going to go run, hide under a rock? By the way, I got vaccinated, so it's too late for me. Anybody going to avoid the vaccination because you're afraid 666 is embedded in it somewhere or another? Anybody? All right, we're having a little fun there. But yeah, seriously, what are we going to do with this? Don't make me call on you.
At least from my perspective, what I do with it is I just say, wow, the Bible is coming true right before our eyes, and we live in a very unique time, in my opinion. So to me, it just strengthens my faith. And, you know, if I'm alive to see some of these things happen, I just know God's faithful and true, and I will hold on to him because I know it's going to end. So it encourages me. I mean, I don't want to live through it, but if I do, I do.
Amen. I agree. I think it encourages our heart, and it tells me that the Church of Jesus Christ, and this word used in a wrong connotation can be negative, but please know I don't mean to use it in a negative way, but the Church of Jesus Christ has to become more cultic. We have to become more insular. We have to become an institution that, you know, Neil was talking about being put out of, excommunicated from Judaism. It was called unsynagogued. You were unsynagogued. And because you were unsynagogued, you couldn't buy kosher foods and you couldn't deal with anybody who was in good standing in Judaism. The goal was to turn you over and treat you like an infidel so that you would miss the fellowship so much you would repent of your behavior. So I think we have to come into a group that is close and strategic like that. Everything that we do outside, and I call it, for lack of a better phrase, extracurricular activities, whether it's it's soccer teams or whatever, we need to put that emphasis in doing that with one another in the church. You know, have a basketball team in your church, have a soccer league, do whatever you can amongst one another, so that when they cut the cord, it doesn't hurt us because we're self-sufficient, because we depend upon the Lord. It's going to happen. Don't believe it. You know, my grandmother said, you may not believe fat meat is greasy, but fat meat is greasy. Okay? It's going to happen. So you need to go ahead and start making, you know, you're in the world, but not of the world, building up the kingdom of God, that you have a refuge, a place to go to flee from this oncoming world. Because, I mean, we're going to be here till the Lord takes us home. And everything that's in that book is going to happen. And I don't know if many people recognize, Judaism has gotten so secular, I don't know if they even do this anymore, Jim. But remember, if you were Jew and you got tattooed, you couldn't even be buried in a Jewish cemetery, because you defiled the body.
Interesting. And now, my goodness,
it's just, you know, yeah, it's just unbelievable how far we've gone.
Yeah. Hey, that said, Andy, why don't we make that the last word, which means you need to pray us out.
Okay, not a problem. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, you are so good and you're so gracious. And Lord, we depend upon you and your son that you sent to redeem us of our sins. We recognize that even though everything looks like it's spinning out of control and everything looks chaotic, but you have everything in your hands. You have a purpose, you have a plan, and it will come to fruition. And that we are saved in the center of your will. So we trust you, we adore you, we give you all the honor and praise in the precious name of your son and our savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, that we ask it all, and all God's children said, amen.
Amen.
Amen.